Welcome to Advanced TV Herstory, where hearty discussion of all things TV draws a nifty circle around the women who have made it all happen. In each installment, we endeavor to celebrate, educate, illustrate, or analyze, all in the hopes of reaching listeners with the message that TV and women are very much a part of our lives. And it's okie dokie, it's fine and dandy that we talk about it, at length, in detail, with delight. So find this podcast along the great ones at Libsyn, Google Music, iTunes, and Auto Radio. Engage with us on Twitter. Our handle is at TV Herstory. I'm your host, Cynthia Bemis Abrams. I hope you enjoy this installment. Welcome, loyal listeners of Advanced TV Herstory. We have with us today a guest who has been with us in the past. Susan Silver and I spoke last fall. We were talking about politics and about all of the women who have been bringing us political commentary through the 2016 presidential election and some of those other elections that were taking place for the U.S. House and Senate and some of the other important seats and ballot questions that were going on across the country last year. And Susan and I have remained loyal Twitter followers and forwarders and just generally continue the conversation about women in and of TV because it's an expansive topic and there's a lot to talk about. So we're here today in this particular segment of Advanced TV Herstory to talk about Susan's upcoming book, her memoir, The Whole Story, and how it is that you take a career in writing for TV and just being part of the entertainment industry and bring us some stories that have some relevance to today, to women who are in the field or simply just fascinated by the field of entertainment. So welcome, Susan Silver.
Thank you very much.
And we are working today off of Zencaster, so trying to bring you the best possible audio quality we can. And for anybody who listens to podcasts, they know that it is trial and error. So we are keeping our fingers crossed. So, Susan, I got a chance to read the first 45 pages of your book. The ebook that you sent did not bear the full content the way you had hoped, but I got a really good taste of some of the great stories you have to offer. So that's some of what we're going to talk about, and you're going to help us understand how it is that we can come to purchase your book in a couple different formats, it sounds like. So let's talk about Hot Pants in Hollywood, which is the title of your book. And I'll be the first one to bite on this question that you'll be asked numerous times, because I guess what? I'm one of your first interviews.
Yes.
About the book. Is that right?
Number one, honey.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, the heat, the pressure. What made you arrive at the title Hot Pants in Hollywood?
Well, first of all, I didn't really start it. Years ago, I actually wore hot pants to meetings. I am so sorry, feminist Gloria Steinem, forgive me as I've begged before, but it was what we did in those days, and I wore them, and it got me this fabulous article in TV Guide, which was called The Writer Wore Hot Pants. There's a picture of me on my balcony in hot pants with a typewriter. So when I decided to do the book, I thought, ooh, that would be good, but I couldn't get the rights to the TV Guide article and picture. So a friend of mine helped me brainstorm what would be a good way to use the title, and we came up with this. And then I got a wonderful illustrator, Joey Heiberg, to do her version of me in hot pants, and there we have it. And by the way, the subtitle of the book is Sex, Secrets, and Sitcoms, in that order, I would say.
And so I found the cover to be very attractive. Is that the artwork then that you're referencing?
Yes, I just love it. It's cheerful, it's fun, it's yellow, which is my favorite color, and I think it'll pop at the bookstores. I went in the other day to a bookstore, and there are thousands of books, so you want yours to stand out, and here is this cheerful yellow caricature in hot pants, and I think it's good, if I do say so myself, which I didn't do it, so I can say it.
And the artist again is?
Joey Heiberg, who has a wonderful, her own website, which is The Art of Joey. She does all kinds of cups and saucers and gift items called Dolly Mamas.
Oh, fun. All right. Well, that's something else to look at. All right. So after all these years, here we are, 2017. You've been in the business many decades.
Another century.
What prompted you to write your memoir?
Well, I'll tell you what happened, and it was kind of interesting. A couple years ago, I went to a party at Vanity Fair. A friend of mine took me. It was celebrating a photographer over the years there. And I was sitting talking with one of the editors and the great honcho, Graydon Carter, and we were talking about how somehow, like Zelig, I've met every icon of my generation, a lot of music people. I went to college with Jim Morrison. I was in the movies Viva Las Vegas with Elvis. And they said, oh, that's a good article. So I said, okay, I'll write it up. And then they said, you know, it's more than an article. This is probably a book. I said, okay. So I started to write a book. And I went through various incarnations. At first, it was going to be about all the name droppings. And then I realized I kind of wanted it to be more than that. So in the second incarnation, it became what it is. And 2 years later, 2.5 years later, actually, here it is, alive and well.
And though you are an accomplished writer, you know, you've been writing all these years. What is the hardest part about writing a memoir?
Well, I think there are several things. First of all, you know, when you're writing television, it's collaborative. You're in a room. Now they write all together at the same time. We didn't in our day. We pitched a story and then we went home and wrote it ourselves. But when you're at home alone writing your book, you're not sure how it's going. That's number one. Then you don't know how much to leave in and leave out. So at the end, I got a fabulous editor, Leslie Wells, who is Mitch Albom's editor, and all of his Tuesday with Maury and all his wonderful books. I'm hoping I have 1/10 of his success. And she kind of helped me shape it and say, well, this is repetitive, or how about more about this? And so then it came into its own. And then I kind of did a final pass in which I did it the way I wanted to. Everybody was telling me, oh, you have to have more as this, or you have to name names, or you have to do that. And I said, you know what? I'm going to do it just the way I want. And so the final version is pretty much the way I want it. So let's see how that goes.
And after a career as long as yours in the business, you deserve to have it the way you want it.
Well, thank you very much. So I want you to go out and buy 1,000 books and we'll be on the way, honey.
I have to pre-order mine, but rest assured, because you are coming to the Midwest, I know that I will be standing in line for you to autograph mine. How's that?
Oh, that's so kind. I am doing a bunch of book events in California, in Milwaukee, my hometown, maybe in Chicago and Aspen, all to be announced on my website. So can I give the plug for the website in case people want more information?
Let's plug it at the beginning and we'll plug it again at the end. Sure.
Okay. It's www, as they all are, hotpantsinhollywood.com. That's easy. And oh, for your wonderful listeners, there's a free chapter. If they go in, they can ask for it. It's not in the book. It's kind of a fun chapter to give you a free taste of what the book's all about. And then you can order the book.
Excellent. So, as you said, your hometown is Milwaukee, and it sure sounds as though you've spent a portion of your career in Hollywood, a portion of your career in New York. I have to say, though, I just have to ask, did you ever work in anywhere other than the East or West Coast?
Well, when I was a kid, I worked in a record store during college. Does that count? In Milwaukee, Wisconsin? No, gosh, now I feel really, really failing. No, I wish I had. Actually, wait a minute. I lied. I did. I went to London to do research on a fabulous project, which would have been wonderful, but unfortunately, we never went further. There was a wonderful story on 60 Minutes years ago about World War II soldiers, American soldiers, being stationed in England and having relationships with English women, and babies were born, and they never knew their American fathers. So I was hired by a wonderful producer, Ed Sherrick, to go and do research on this film. And I wrote a screenplay, which we never made, but it was a fabulous experience going and meeting all these, well, they're adults now, children of GIs, American GIs, who had never known their fathers. Very interesting.
So it really has been a multifaceted career, not just writing comedy, but kind of getting into the breadth of the human experience and the American experience. So with this constellation of names that you chose to drop and some you chose not to drop that you mention in your book, and you've collaborated, you've socialized, you really have traveled in some amazing circles, and that's what readers get to find out. Who among them are truly the ones who you believe influenced you the most? And why do you think that? Why do they resonate with you as strong memories even today?
Well, my manager, of course, Gary Marshall, one of the great icons of television who passed away recently, was
the one who really got me into it. I had a partner named Iris Rayner Dart, who later went on to write Beaches. And she and I wrote a Love American Style for Gary. And she kind of retired for a little bit to have a baby, or took a break, I should say. And I saw the Mary Tyler Moore Show, and I said, Gary, I can do this show. I worked in a local TV station in L.A. I'm from the Midwest. I know how to do this. And he got me in there, and that was my first break. So he and the guys at MTM were really my mentors and gave me my chance.
And when you say the guys at MTM, do you mean?
Jim Brooks, Alan Burns, Lorenzo Music, David Davis were the four wonderful executives, the executive producers and the producers of that show, who went out of their way to look for women. And Treva Silverman had started, and then I think I was the second woman. And from then on, they hired a lot of women.
And speak a little bit more about the culture there, because as many listeners know, we've done three segments about the Mary Tyler Moore Show that got in depth into the culture, into kind of how women were enabled to bring their best ideas forward, to be supported in that environment. So from your firsthand perspective, because I didn't know you at the time that I was producing those, share a little bit more about what that work experience was like, and maybe why it was so special compared with any other experience you had.
Well, first of all, at the time, there were very, very few women writing or involved in television. I think Lucille Ball had hired Madeline Davis. That was about it. Marlo Thomas was the first, really, to executive produce her own show. But even they didn't bring in a lot of writers. Iris and I went and did a That Girl, as a matter of fact. But it was never shot because it was about Anne-Marie getting married. And Marlo decided at that time that she really wanted to keep her as a single career woman. And because she was running the show, she got to make that decision. So the Mary Tyler Moore guys were not interested in an agenda or politics. They really wanted to show women realistically. And they were smart enough and confident enough in themselves to know that the best way to do that would be to get women to work on the show. And they actively sought us out. And just by our being there, it changed the dynamic. It changed the way women talked. It paralleled what was going on in society, which was the beginning of feminism. I was just recently married, and I had a career which was kind of not the norm. All my friends from Wisconsin went to Madison to get their MRSs, and I had gone to Northwestern because I wanted to be a writer, and then I escaped to California. So it was really the first show that opened the door for women, and I think why it's so iconic today and why women felt that it represented their lives.
So over the years, what role have you played in mentoring women or giving them access to your network of influential people, opening doors for them, or in what other ways have you used your experience to empower women writers in particular to help them navigate the entertainment world?
Well, I hope in several ways. First of all, I had been an old casting person, so when I would write my scripts, I would always think in terms of casting, and I would automatically write in woman judge or woman lawyer, because the casting people, not that they were prejudiced against women, they just were always casting men, so that made a difference in itself. That was always one of my prime things. And I did work with a couple of other women writers to help them break in. And then when I was a story editor at Square Pegs, of course, that was a fun job because I really like working with other writers, and there were a lot of younger Saturday Night Live writers on that staff, so that was enjoyable. I taught, and I enjoyed very much, for 6 summers I did a TV Academy class from pitch to polish, how to pitch your story, go all the way to the polish of the script. It's a very difficult world to break into, male or female. And I think that you have to be extremely lucky. Nowadays, of course, there are other ways to do it through the internet, through smaller little venues. But in those days, it was just a rough hoe. And I tell you the truth, because I was so very lucky, I didn't feel the prejudice. I was extremely lucky. Starting out on Mary Tyler Moore was like the top. And I say it was downhill for 20 years after that.
Pitch to polish. Tell me a little bit more about what that was all about and where you worked on that and what some of the good things were that came out of it.
Well, the TV Academy in New York started a program for adult writers who wanted to become television writers. And 4 or 5 of us that were in the biz used to teach this class. It was a 6-week summer class, and it was about 20 people and 2 teachers a class. And we would teach them how to pitch their stories. then we would work on the story ideas. Then they'd go write their outline. We'd critique it. Then their first draft, second draft. And what was so really good about it, we brought in actors to read their scripts afterwards. So it was a real great experience for novice writers. And some of them, like Jim Colucci, who's a friend of mine, he went on to write the Golden Girls book. And I've actually kept in touch with a couple of them, but it was a wonderful thing. And then we also did some of the smaller versions at the TV Paley Center, where we would do like a lecture about how to do it compressed into one night.
That sounds like a lot of fun. And I mean, I honestly don't know if there are those opportunities out there today. I realize that that certainly, it, as you say, compresses into 6 weeks. What some people would think requires a four-year degree or I don't know. That just, it's fascinating. If I had that opportunity, I think I might sign up. So are you going to teach again soon? I hope so.
When I was in college back in the day in the other century, we knew nothing about the real world. I mean, I literally hadn't seen a script until I took a graduate class from Francis Ford Coppola and wrote a screenplay. Nowadays, they're so much more sophisticated at colleges. Plus, there are all these programs on how to write scripts. So it's a different world. And as I say, I've been a little removed from it for a while, so I'm sure things have improved greatly.
And so you also brought up Square Pegs, which I have not done an installment on because it's such a fascinating show from 81, 82, I want to say, 82, 83, something like that. And it ran for just one season and was a fascinating look at, again, a very woman-oriented high school, the toughest times of high school for two young women who are trying to find their way in the social setting of a California high school. How much fun was it to be on that show?
No fun at all. It was a nightmare. It was such a great idea with such a great cast. And as I said, some of the Saturday Night Live people were there, and it was a different culture. And there's a wonderful article in TV Guide about it, as a matter of fact. It was a very stress-filled few months, and I left in the middle, enough said. How's that for a curveball?
It sounds like you've experienced a couple different significant experiences where either there's chemistry behind the scenes that kind of puts out good scripts and keeps a culture going where people are engaged and ready to deliver their best, and that requires leadership. Any other thoughts about, you know, you'd mentioned Gary Marshall. Gary Marshall, it just feels like a phenomenon, you know, and that can't be replicated for every show. Any other thoughts on who other big leaders were that you worked with?
Well, Gary was wonderful, and he had also he believed in nepotism with Penny Marshall and all that stuff. But he also had started a business for his father where he managed young writers. And from him came, all the Love American style people and an awful lot of other people. And he was really unique because he was a very lovely guy and always wanted people to be nice. That was his word, nice. You'll all be nice to each other. He had a very New York accent. And he was terrific. And Jim and Alan were great in another way. They were so supportive and welcoming. And, you know, there were other producers who were not so. And I was very fortunate in that because I had started with a great show, I was very lucky and I never wanted to be anywhere that wasn't fun and wonderful. And a lot of places, you know, were in between, shall we say, and some were awful. But the truth of it is that nowadays, it's a much more intimate thing where you're working in a room with a bunch of writers. We didn't do that. We pitched our stories, and then, as I said, we went home and did our own scripts. So the feeling at a show is so important now, and the leadership is so important to be inclusive. And I know that there are some shows that must be wonderful to work on and some that aren't. I don't know what they are, however, at this point.
So Square Pegs was 1982, 1983. If that was about 10 years or so after you were doing work with the Mary Tyler Moore people, when you were writing then for Square Pegs, was that in the group environment or was that the pitch your show and then crank it out yourself?
No, it was individually. And that's why being the executive story consultant was such fun because I got to work with the other writers and help them develop their things. And I learned something from my own experience, and it seems to be logical, but I don't know why people don't get it. In life, as well as show business, when you're dealing with other people, start out with the good things. Wow, this is great script. It's wonderful. Here are a couple things. Why don't we think about this?
instead of coming in and starting with what's wrong with things. I think if people learn that in general, they get along much better.
Absolutely. And that's just good managerial leadership advice across the board, you know, whatever your industry, whatever your role in an organization is. So Square Pegs with Sarah Jessica Parker and Amy Linker. And those are DVDs you just have to cherish. It's a great show.
I'll tell you who did start there and who is like a phenomenon now is Andy Borowitz, who was one of the young writers. He had just come from Harvard, and now he's got one of the best, of course, satire blogs with The New Yorker. He's quite amazing, and he was quite brilliant and funny. And there were some very talented people there. It just was a very undisciplined and a little allegedly druggy scene, and I was a little older than that, so there you go.
Let's talk a little bit about that class of women that you mentioned, you know, from your days on Love American Style, Mary Tyler Moore, Maude. It felt like there's a certain amount of fluidity that you described of the group of women who were trying to make these things happen. Do you stay in touch with them? I mean, have you worked with them? Continue? Do you think about things? Do you talk? Is this a class?
No. I'll tell you the truth. Because, as I said, we were all working individually, we never did. There was a very famous, and there is a very famous writer named Susan Harris, who started out on the Norman Lear group when I started out on the Mary Tyler Moore group, and we were known as the Two Susans. She went on to develop and create a lot of shows, and she's much wealthier than I am. Wow, is she doing well. And I lost track of Treva. A couple of the other writers I run into occasionally, but we were few and far between, and we weren't bonding in the way that perhaps they do now. The Tina Fey's and all the gals that worked on Saturday Night Live, that's a very unique, interesting world. And by the way, that's another show. Lauren sure gave women opportunities.
It's kind of too bad that it feels like you all were working in silos, obviously chipping away at the glass ceiling and creating opportunities and creating a wake for the women who had come behind you, and yet never had that opportunity to either leverage everyone's best effort to create something perhaps a little bit larger or a little bit more influential, a network that could have served. And I always think you can only do so much in a day, and you guys were doing some tremendous work, but interesting that the isolation was such that it sort of prevented something more powerful perhaps from arising. And that's not too late, though.
Well, there was something actually called Women in Film, and I was one of the first people there. My friend Sue Cameron, who had a column for The Hollywood Reporter, and Tishy Wilkerson, who was the publisher, started this fabulous group, Women in Film, which has lasted all this time and still is tremendously good at doing just what you're saying, you know, networking among women. So that was one attempt at it.
Okay, so there was some collaboration, understanding that that women needed more support, more infrastructure in the industry, and there's a number of different organizations, and some of them even have state organizations as well, because you have a lot of smaller production houses and things in all along the East Coast, in Illinois, Toronto, lots of places for opportunity, and they are the ones who are a little bit closer to boots on the ground, bringing up writers and directors and creating opportunities.
And you.
And me.
Look what you're doing.
Yes. Well, podcasters are a little outside. You know, we're not radio people, but we do have some power, and we're starting to buy our ink by the gallon, our virtual ink. So back to ink and your book. We're talking about Hot Pants in Hollywood. And what's the three-word tagline?
Sex, secrets, and sitcoms.
By Susan Silver. So how's that for all the
alliteration?
So we're here to talk a little bit more about Hot Pants in Hollywood and the highlights and the career accomplishments that Susan Silver had the incredible good fortune to live. And so, Susan, share with us just one or two of those particular accomplishments that stand out to you as the ones you're really most proud of, the ones where you dug deep, you put your best writing forward, and you look back at that and you say, yep, that's me.
Well, as I always say, starting on top, my first Mary Tyler Moore show was about a very peppy, overly friendly old friend from Mary's in camp who became the receptionist at the station. Twinks, her name was. And my
ex-husband and I had gone out looking for a house, and the real estate guy's name was Arnold Tvedt, T-V-E-D-T. I say that's a name you can't kill with a stick. I mean, it's just, it's a weird name. Anyway, so I called her Twinks Tvedt. And the great thing about that script was every woman can identify with the fact of sometimes you have to stand up for a wedding for a woman you don't love that much, and then she gives you this hideous dress. So it happened to Mary, and then it also happened to Rhoda. And that script, of all the scripts I've ever written, was the least touched by any other human hand. They left most of my stuff in, which was such a glorious thing, because most of the time, even on Mary, they rewrote a little, although they did encourage us to come to the rewrite sessions. Other shows, you'd turn in your script, and then God knows what would show up. So that was a really great highlight. And then my first movie of the week, which was called The Couple Takes a Wife, which had been based on a magazine article in, I think it was Ms., actually, about a working woman having to have a wife in addition. So she hired someone, and it was Paul Apprentice, Bill Bixby, and they hired Valerie Perrine, which anybody who knows about nannies stealing your husbands would never do nowadays. So, but that was really fun because I got to write my husband and myself. And I always wrote from my own life, and my Maud was about my mother, and my Bob Newhart's were about my husband. So using your own life experience was lots of fun.
Is it possible that because you wrote the bridesmaid's gag for Mary, and that has been repeated countless times, pretty much any female-oriented show at some point in time has a wedding, and our heroine or our protagonist ends up in a wedding wearing a hideous dress. Do you think you were the first to write that?
Probably not, but I do think that because there were so few women writing for television, it hadn't been on television before, and that's why when people saw it, they all could relate because they had all gone through it themselves. Again, when you're just, I've used this example so many times, but Alan and Jim, who were so open to women's stuff, would say something like, okay, then Mary goes and gets cleaned up. And I'd say, excuse me, women don't go get cleaned up. We take a bath, we take a shower. It's just a little thing, but it's a woman's consciousness that hadn't been shown before. And I'm sure Lucy wore some hideous dress at some point. So
the lesson for budding writers and anyone who thinks that they're in a situation to really bring a story forward is to think first and foremost from your family perspective, your personal experience, and bring it forward. And I think that's really sound advice. And obviously coming from someone who's got the accomplishments behind writing some of the most profound early women's comedy that there is. So
yes, with Fire, we came up with these things at the same time that Mel Brooks came up with Fire.
Moving on to a more serious topic, because as I continue to plow through topics of women in and of TV, invariably it sort of comes back to what the current situation is for those who are in the field, women who are thinking of getting into the field, and what they're seeing in the headlines, and preparing them for success, or in fact increasing their skill sets so that they can handle the next challenge that comes to them in the workplace. And so, unfortunately, it feels as though actresses and crew members every week, whether it's you're reading the Huffington Post or the New York Times or People magazine, they're talking more and more about toxic working conditions, about pay disparity, about just the lack of respect. Oh my goodness, we found out that even somebody was counting up how many times the Supreme Court justices, the women Supreme Court justices, are interrupted, and it's at a much higher rate than the male Supreme Court justices are interrupted. The toxic working conditions and the harassment in particular, because I don't know that any Supreme Court justice is going to be listening to this podcast anytime soon.
I don't know that Ruth Bader Ginsburg loves to laugh and go to the opera, and she's probably listening right now.
She'd love this podcast. Okay, so I'm not going to ask you to talk about any of the conditions that you, in retrospect, wish you perhaps had more power to change, or any harassment that you might have felt. That's not why we're here. But rather, I guess, from the strength of your career in the field, what would you say to those who have had the courage to come forward, whether it's the Bill Cosby allegations or anybody else, those who have actually come forward, who have put their names out there? You know, you're a veteran. What do you say to them?
Well, first of all, it's such an interesting phenomenon because, as I say, when I look back, I honestly didn't feel any kind of harassment. What we did find, Iris and I once went to a meeting and a producer was so rude, he put his feet up, I'll never forget, he took his shoes off and put his feet up in our face on the desk. So we called him Feet from then on. And one time we did go into a producer's office and up on the wall he had a lot of pictures of nude women from Playboy. I said it was like being in a padded cell of the Playboy mansion. But we were very determined in those days, and maybe, you know, ignorance is bliss. Nowadays, of course, the kind of things that happened at Fox, that happened with Bill O'Reilly, are so unbelievable and so despicable and need to be dealt with legally. But I really feel that on a personal level, one has to stand up for oneself in any kind of circumstance. And I think that all of these recent experiences that are coming forth now are going to open the door to a lot better situation. And I really think that the tide is turning now. I think this whole Fox thing has opened the door to a real sea change in what is acceptable and what is not.
There's no question that the sunshine that happens every time one more person, one more woman comes forward has got to be helpful. I kind of feel like every time I have a woman who has been there, who is a feminist, who is in a position to say something, and you have a number of different avenues that you write and speak for, I just want to make sure that you're on record as being one who is going to encourage them and remind them that what they're doing, as painful as it is necessary for the next generation.
We have a radio broadcast, a commentary I do for a small NPR affiliate called Robin Hood Radio. It's WHDD. And one of the things, I talk about media, I talk about culture, I talk about politics. And one other thing, I have a feature called Oh Come On, which are things that just piss me off and how I tell people to stand up. And a lot of the stuff is going to the top. I mean, I believe any kind of circumstance where you've been taken advantage of, just even in a organizational way or in a product way or in anything, you go right to the top and you Google the head of the company and you Google the press department and, you know, you do it that way, because going to customer service essentially won't get you any good. So I believe in speaking up in all manners of life, and I'm sure it's made me some enemies, but hey.
Well, you know, has it? I guess that would be the question. There's an awful lot flying around out there. And while our old selves might have thought that it would have, you know, if what we're worried about is the popularity contest, then sure, maybe a few enemies. But on the other hand, you're also making changes and you are reminding women that we all have to speak up for ourselves. And sometimes we also have to stand by our sisters.
Oh, for sure. I mean, there's a wonderful baby boomer site called Growing Bolder, and I do them quite often, and I love, there are two guys who do it, I love them, but I said to them the first time, I don't think I could grow any bolder, I probably have to grow less bold, but that's not a problem I've ever had. But of course, I expect that we always support sisters going through something. And you know, the really sad thing is that at some point, once in a while, and I'll be honest about this, the roughest experiences I had were with other women, because back in the day there were so few places for women that women who had made it sometimes weren't as eager to give a helping hand to other women. So I think that's changed, and I think that's a real plus.
Let's talk for a minute, though, about, and I'm not asking you to name names, in your career.
Oh, I love to name names. What is it?
Well, this is perhaps more one to protect a relationship. Have you ever experienced a situation where, being a feminist and someone who's been in the entertainment industry, have you ever been approached by someone who has shared with you that they've been harassed or that the toxic environment is almost untenable and they're concerned about coming forward? Have you ever provided that kind of assistance?
No, I have not. And again, I say I was so darn lucky that in the beginning, first of all, when you have a strong guy being your backer, your mentor, like Gary Marshall, the guys at MTM wouldn't have seen me without his backing. Once they saw me, they respected him. And, you know, it's always good to have someone in your corner. That's number one. And number two, I think it's all a matter of timing. You know, at the beginning of feminism, we were riding a crest of a wave. I remember Iris and I
went to a meeting once of women protesting and everything. And I thought to myself, you know, there's two things we can do. We can either march, which is certainly a good way to do it, or we can do our work so well that we open the door for other people. And that was kind of the route we took. And I do think when you're successful, it's like, oh, well, they can do it. Let's get another one of them.
Everybody has a different role to play in advancing progress. You just need to find, I think, what you do best and recognize that you can't give up. And that sort of leads me into the next and kind of final question within this regard of, you know, Susan giving advice to those who are feeling challenged in a pretty tough industry, as you described it. What kind of words of inspiration do you provide with regard to just having that confidence, to keeping the confidence and the thick skin and the belief in yourself, and about persisting, which is the word of the year?
I will tell you something I discovered in writing my book. I always saw myself as a very super sensitive, not very resilient person. And because when I started out, I had success in the beginning, I played on that and that helped me proceed. And had I not had success, I think I probably would have given up. But now as I look at my life overall, in personal life as well as work, in dealing with issues of sickness or sadness or taking care of elderly parents or all those things that women do and the roles that women play in that, I found out I was much more resilient than I thought. And so it's kind of, I hope to be inspirational to other women. You don't have to feel like you're always on top. Just keep going and somehow you'll come out on top. It's kind of an interesting phenomenon.
There's nothing easy about this life, but you also have to find your opportunity to celebrate and have fun and laugh.
Laughing. That's the big thing. I swear, my sense of humor has got, mostly I do it for myself. I've had some illness and things like that. And some of the chapters in my book, towards the end of the book, are, you know, things not to do in a hospital. And it's all funny because otherwise you can't get through stuff. And I've been very fortunate in that I make myself laugh, and that's how I get through. So you're absolutely right. Laughter is the best tool.
It is. Now, I'm going to let you rifle to your calendar, your schedule, and we're going to talk a little bit about this book of yours, Hot Pants in Hollywood, and where people are going to see you, how they can go about buying it, and any other things people need to know about how to hear the voice, read the words of Susan Silver. Where are you heading in the next couple months?
Well, that's very kind of you, honey. First of all, again, as I say, if you go on my website, I have a wonderful woman named Linda Lee who designed what I think is the coolest website. It moves. It does things. I'm like, you know, very internet unsavvy. And I had this kind of flat, boring website. And she said, no, let me take a hand. And it's just great what she did. So it's got blog. It's got press. It's got where I'm going to be, and it's got articles about me. It's all about me. No, but it's really a fun site. So that's www.hotpantsinhollywood. And in that, you will learn, so far I'm going to be in California, where my goddaughter lives in Sausalito, June 1st at Book Passages. And then I'm going to be in LA and Brentwood, June 4th. Whoops, somebody just emailed me to say, come visit us. No. And then I'm going to be June 20th in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And all my high school friends are coming, which will be so much fun. I haven't been back there in years and years. And then July 6th, I'm in Aspen at the Explorers Bookstore. And then I have a lot of press coming up. And if you want to buy the book now, you can go into all the sites, Amazon, Google, Barnes & Noble, etc. The ebook is available, I think, the 14th. And the print book is available the 27th, so you can pre-order. And there are pluses and minuses to both. The ebook, of course, lots of people like to read on their Kindles, and it has the photographs in color, which is kind of cool. But the print book has the cover, which I think is, as I said, so delightful. I didn't do it, so I can brag about it. And I think it's a very cheerful book to have in your house. And it's kind of, you know, six of one, six of another. So I would really love it if everybody goes and buys it and then cuts on the website and comments. That's what I really am looking forward to, is the ability we have now to hear from the readers. And there's a comment section on the website where you can tell me what you think or what you like or anything that strikes a chord. And I, as I said, I hope the book is inspirational to young women and also is recognizable to the boomers, because
I have had this kind of boomer life on steroids where I've gone through everything that we've all gone through, divorce, dating, elderly parents, illness, dating. I'll just keep throwing in dating because I'm still doing it.
And then where are we finding you today?
Well, to tell you the truth, on my other life, I'm extremely political, so I don't want to annoy anybody, but on Twitter and Facebook, I'm kind of engaged in that aspect of my life. I do write pieces on the Huffington Post, whatever comes to mind. I just started, I go to Renaissance Weekend, which is this wonderful thing where, no, we don't dance around, you know, in dirndls with flute. But you're invited to talk about your area of expertise. And I met a gal who worked for Huffington Post. I didn't even know what it was. And she said, would you like to submit a piece? And I did. And I've done a lot of political stuff, but I've also done stuff about writing and about my career, et cetera, et cetera. That's a good thing. And on my radio podcast, as I said, I do politics, culture, media, and things that piss me off, which usually have to do with noise. I have something called hypercussis, which is the super sensitivity to noise. And today, I actually prevailed upon the contractors outside my window to stop for an hour, which I'm very, very excited about. Anyway, so Robin Hood Radio, Susan Says is what that's called. And then I'm doing, you know, a lot of press for the book. And there's a couple websites that I'm writing pieces about for that, too. So it's lots of fun. And I'm enjoying myself again after a year of kind of negativity and rejection and thinking, oh my gosh, am I ever going to finish this? Now it's real. It's out and about. When I got a hold of the book, I actually cried the first time I saw it because it was so cool. And it was just, and I put pictures up on the internet about it. So yeah, it's an empowering thing. And that's one thing I will say to women, you know, some of you are very persistent and some of us are not. Some of us get easily discouraged, but we find out over the long haul that we've succeeded. Just keep doing it because there's nothing better than realizing that you've accomplished something that you've wanted or you've thought about. And it feels good, guys, I promise you.
And those are probably the words of inspiration that everyone should carry forward. Everybody has an opportunity to make a difference, to bring their voice forward, and to recognize that their thoughts and their experience has tremendous value. And we as the sisterhood need to keep telling ourselves that. So thank you for leaving us with that message, because you've been in so many different places, in so many different rooms, and had the opportunity to channel positive, fun messages that's where we want to leave it today. So thank you, Susan Silver. We wish you all the best on your travels to promote your book, Hot Pants in Hollywood, and hope that you run into all sorts of old co-workers and new people who want to take your writing and your voice to a different level. We hope to keep you in the fray as long as we can, because it's fun to talk to you, and you continue to just be out there thinking about the women in and of TV, and you're part of our community.
Thank you so much. I loved it.
It is always a pleasure chatting with Susan Silver, and if you've enjoyed this interview, then zip over to our website, tvherstory.com, where you'll find the vault of all the past podcast installments, as well as scripts where they are applicable, tvherstory.com. And if you like this podcast and aren't already a subscriber, oh my goodness, you can find us on Apple Podcasts, which used to be iTunes, and also at our hosting site, Libsyn, Libsyn. Go ahead, fill in the information, and become a subscriber, an RSS feed. Always, 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 we are available to receive your thoughts, ideas, and questions at advancedtvherstory@gmail.com. And you can also shoot us a note on Twitter. Our handle there is TV Herstory. Finally, Advanced TV Herstory is a proud member of Core Temp Arts Podcast Network, which is a place, coretemparts.com, where you will find other entertainment-related shows. TV, more of the 21st century version, but every once in a while you get folks chatting about the old shows or doing comparisons or what reboots are looking like. And these are a group of very talented, creative, independent podcasters. Please support them as well. A good friend of mine, Chris Revel, hosts a show called Let's Chat, and he's got lots to say, and he's got a newborn baby to talk about as well. Finally, my thank yous. My thank yous start off with one big one to Susan Silver, and I wish you all the best in the publication of your book, the book tour that you have planned, and reconnecting with lots of good people who love the shows that you were part of. My thank you to David Brown, who is the audio technician extraordinaire and is helping me learn all sorts of new ways to further get this podcast out the door at the highest quality possible. And lastly, to you all, listeners of this podcast, for your support through your referrals, your recommendations, your sharing, the likes you give it, the links you send me, or your notes. You really are the best. I'm your host, Cynthia Bemis Abrams. Until next time.
Thank you for listening to the Court and Parts Podcast Network. To listen to more Court and Parts shows, visit courtandparts.com.